Hi everyone, my name is Annika. Thank you for joining today. Today we're going to walk through a sample chem phys passage, and it's going to be all about electrostatics and magnetism, everyone's favorite physics topic. So let's just get right into it. Normally I like to recommend spending about like 8-ish minutes on a passage like this, but for today we're just going to walk through it all out, so it will take a little bit longer. So let's just get into it. I'm going to go ahead and read and highlight what I think is important, and then we'll talk through some of the important figures in this passage. So, while conducting experiments on the tissue of a newly identified type of tumor, researchers discovered a previously unidentified molecule, molecule alpha. Preliminary experiments with molecule alpha indicate that it is charged, and researchers' first plan is to calculate its charge by placing a sample between two of a large parallel plate capacitor. After charging the capacitor using a 9-volt battery, the researchers measure a 1 × 10⁻¹² Newton force pulling molecule alpha towards the negatively charged plate. Okay, let's take a look at the figure that they give us to sort of make sense of the words that we just read. So here we know that we're putting the sample in between something. So here we have our sample that adds up. We're putting it between the two plates of a parallel plate capacitor. So this looks like it's our capacitor. We know that capacitors have electric fields through them. And so we see the electric field. We know that the electric field is pointing downwards just by the way the field lines look. We also have a distance for our electric field, which is great. And we know that this is an electric field because we have a QV right here in this sort of circuit situation. Okay, so that's, I think, all we need to take away from that figure. Let's keep reading. Researchers perform a second experiment to determine the mass of the molecule using a cyclotron. A cyclotron contains a tunnel with an electric field and magnetic field pointing in perpendicular directions across its width. A charged particle is ejected through the tunnel at a characteristic velocity. The electric field and magnetic field are oriented such that their exerted forces on the molecule sum to zero. That seems important. The particle then emerges from the end of the tunnel into a space where the magnetic field remains, but the electric field is turned off. Remaining under the force of the magnetic field, the particle undergoes circular motion and travels to a distance 2r from the opening of the tunnel. Okay, that was a lot of words. Let's take a look at this picture of a cyclotron. So it looks like we're kind of separating the cyclotron into two parts. There's a first part here, which is characterized by this tunnel that we've been hearing about. And there's a second part here. So if we think about this tunnel, the passage tells us that the electric field and magnetic field are oriented, so their forces are perpendicular to the width of the tunnel. And we also know that their opposite forces sum to zero. So that tells us that they must be pointing in opposite directions. We can see that our electric field lines run downwards. So therefore, our magnetic field lines must point up, our magnetic force must point upwards if our electric force is pointing downwards. We could, if the passage didn't tell us that the net force was zero and we didn't know what direction it was, we could also think about using the right hand rule. And the way I like to do that is to point my hand in the direction of the velocity, curl my fingers in the direction of the B field, the magnetic field, and whichever direction my thumb is pointing is the magnetic force. So for this problem, our velocity is to the right, so I'm going to point my hand this way. We can see X's for our B field, so that means I'm going to curl my fingers into the page. And my thumb is just naturally pointing upwards, so our magnetic force will also be pointing upwards, and that adds up. The electric force downward, magnetic force upwards. So that's the first part when we're in the tunnel. Once the sample leaves the tunnel, we know that we enter this phase where the electric field is supposedly turned off, which means that the only field we have here is the magnetic field, which also means that there's no electric force, there's only magnetic force at this point. We also see our molecule takes sort of a circular trajectory, and that seems like it will be important for later. Okay, that's, I think, pretty much all I want to talk about before we get into the questions. And that's sort of a good understanding of, like, the figure and just sort of extrapolating the text onto what's going on in the experimental setup before you approach the questions. Okay, let's start with number one. What is the magnitude between the or what is the magnitude of the electric field in between the plates of the capacitor? Assume this experiment takes place in a vacuum. Okay, so for this kind of problem, it would probably be really helpful to know the equation for the electric field, for an electric field. If we didn't, however, remember the equation and we are taking our test, one thing we could do is take a look at the units and see if we could reverse engineer the problem. So we see that the numerator of our units is some kind of voltage and the denominator is some kind of distance. This V stands for voltage, not velocity. We know that because it's a capital V. So if we take a look at the values they give us in our problem, we see that we're using a 9-volt battery. That sounds like a good number for our voltage. So let's put that on the numerator. And our distance, we already talked about, was the distance between the two plates, which is 0.01 meters. So if we do 9 divided by 0.01 meters, that's also equal to 9 divided by 1 times 10 to the negative 2, which is also equal to 9 times 10 to the positive 2. And so let me just write that out. 9 times 10 to the positive 2 is equal to 900 volts per meter. And that corresponds to answer choice D. Okay, great. The equation that would have probably been helpful if we had just memorized it was E equals B over D, but as you can see, we were able to get the correct answer without having that memorized. All right, what is the charge of molecule alpha? Okay, so it looks like we have some positive choices and some negative choices. So I think the first step would be to figure out what sign our charge is going to be. So if we remember from any time we learned about magnets, key thing is that opposites will be attracting and like charges will be repelling. So in this case, our passage tells us that there's a force that's pulling the molecule towards a negatively charged plate. If something is just naturally being pulled towards the negative, if it's attracted to the negative, it must be positive. If it was negative, it would be repelled by the negative. So we're going to go ahead and eliminate A and B because we know our charge has to be positive. Unfortunately, we still have to calculate the value of it, but it doesn't hurt to have eliminated it down to 50%. Okay, so what is a charge on molecule alpha? Here's where it's going to be really important to remember some formulas and manipulations of electric fields. And so the formula that's going to be really useful for this problem is F equals EQ. And this is a derivation of Coulomb's law, if any of you guys remember that. And this E is basically referring to the electric field. This Q is referring to our molecule alpha's charge, and the force is essentially the force on molecule alpha that's generated by this electric field. So we have our E, we actually just calculated that in the previous problem. We have our F, our passage tells us, is 1 times 10 to the negative 12. Now let's calculate for Q. So Q equals F over E, which is going to be 1 times 10 to the negative 12 newtons, divided by E, which is going to be 900 volts per meter, which is the same as 9 times 10 to the 2. Volts per meter. I like to separate out my number versus scientific notation part of or exponent part of the math. And so what I'm going to do is 1 over 9 times, let's figure out the 10 to the negative 12th divided by 10 to the 2 is the same as 10 to the negative 14th, which is equal to 0.11 times 10 to the negative 14th, which is equal to 1.1 times 10 to the negative 15th. Okay, lots of calculations, and I have really bad handwriting, but that is our correct answer. 1.1 times 10 to the negative 15th Coulomb. Okay, number 3. At what velocity should a sample of 1,010 molecules be fired into the tunnel so that the tunnel of the cyclotron so that it will make it to the end of the tunnel? Okay, so we can look at the picture again, and we know that we're talking about the tunnel phase as specified by the question. We talked about how here we have an electric force pointing downwards and a magnetic force pointing upwards. The passage tells us that the forces have to sum to zero, and let's think about why that might make sense. If one was greater, let's say for example our electric force was way greater than our magnetic force, That would just automatically incentivize anything we place into the tunnel to shoot straight downwards, right? If our electric force is overpowering our magnetic force, then the molecule wouldn't even want to go horizontally, it would just want to go straight down in the direction of the net force. But if our net forces sum up to be zero, then the molecule has no reason to go up or down. It can go straight across with whatever characteristic velocity we shoot it through the tunnel with. So we know that the basic supposition of what's happening in our experimental setup is that the two forces have to be equal to each other so that their net force is zero since they're in opposite directions. So let's set the forces equal to each other. We talked about already how in the previous question, our electric force is going to be equal to EQ. Now all we have to do is set that equal to our magnetic force and remember what an equation for magnetic force could be. And that equation, which you're going to want to remember for your MCAT, is QVB. B here is referring to magnetic field. If we're solving for V, velocity, we can go ahead and cancel out the Qs, and we're left with V equals E over B, meters per second, and that is A. Okay, you'll notice that I didn't even bother with the fact that we're talking about 1,010 molecules, and the reason for that is because I decided to look at what was happening at a one molecule scale. So for example, EQ is the electric force on one molecule, QVB is also the magnetic force on just one molecule. By doing that, I was able to cancel everything out and look at what the velocity of one molecule would be. Let's think about what this would mean for 1,010 molecules. The force, electric force on 1,010 molecules would just be 1,010 times EQ, and the electric force on, or the magnetic force on 1,010 molecules would just be 1,010 times QVB. Regardless of how many molecules we're looking at, that number will cancel out, so it doesn't really matter how many molecules we have, we're always going to end up with the same net velocity. All right, let's look at number four. What is the acceleration experienced by the sample once it enters a space outside the tunnel? So let's take a look at the picture. If we are outside the tunnel, we are now in the second phase right here. And we know the passage told us that once we've gotten outside the tunnel, our electric field shuts off and we only have a magnetic field. So that means the only force that our molecule is experiencing is a magnetic force. Also, the passage tells us that the molecule undergoes circular motion, and we can kind of see that just by looking at the picture, these dashed lines. The molecule takes a sort of a circular trajectory. And so that is kind of an indication that we're not going to be thinking about normal acceleration here. We want to be thinking about centripetal acceleration. And one thing we'll want to remember is that the equation for centripetal acceleration is V squared over R. Okay, if it was normal acceleration, we could use F equals ma or some derivation of that. But in this case here, we have to use centripetal acceleration. We already solved for V, which is very nice, in our previous question, which we decided was going to be E over B. We'll square that and divide by R, and we end up with E squared over B squared R, which corresponds to A equals E squared over B squared R. Okay, perfect. Lastly, let's take a look at number five. In terms of E, B, Q, and R, what is the mass of the sample? Okay, so we're looking for a mass. One really quick trick for problems like these is just to take a quick look at the answer choices and make sure all of them are in terms of E, B, Q, and R. If any of these answer choices has a variable, which is not a fixed quantity, a variable that's not one of these letters, we can go ahead and eliminate it because it's not in its final form. So in this case, if we look at B, we have an A in our answer. That's an acceleration. Our question is not asking us to get our answer in terms of A, so we can go ahead and eliminate that. Similarly, we can also go ahead and eliminate D. So that's a quick way to just eliminate some things. Unfortunately, we still have to solve the entire problem all out, but we were able to eliminate half the choices. Okay, so what is the mass of the sample? Here is where we want to use our most fundamental ever physics equation, which is F equals ma. And if you go into your MCAT knowing just one equation, I hope it's this one, because this is a very, very versatile equation. And it's gonna come in handy here. So we found our A in our previous problem. We decided that was gonna be E squared over B squared times R. We're looking for M. What about F? And so remember, we're in this phase of a cyclotron where the electric field is turned off. All we have is magnetic field, which means that our force is just purely magnetic force. And we talked about how in a previous question, we talked about how magnetic force is equal to QVB. So solving for M, we can use F over A. And let's just do some algebraic manipulation. F is gonna be QVB, as I just said. A is gonna be V squared over R. One of these V's are gonna cancel out, and we're left with M equals QBR over V. Our V is from question 2, E over B. So this is going to be QBR over E over B. Bear with me, I know my handwriting is really terrible. And that is going to equal QB squared R over E. Okay, lots of algebra, and I was writing it really slow on this board, but that corresponds to, let's just make sure, QB squared R over E, QB squared R over E, perfect. Okay, that corresponds to letter choice C. Okay, great. So yeah, that wraps up this passage. Please feel free to email me or comment if you have any questions.